morning, everyone. The aim of my talk this morning is to share a little bit of a vision. I don't want to say to share a dream, because that somebody before me already said it some time ago. So I want to share a little bit of a vision that has been motivating and is behind not all of what we do, but is a little bit the driving force and the big aim of where we want to arrive. So what I will try to explain to you is why Durban, with a very nice new stadium, wants to become a quantum city. So I have to start by telling you what we mean by a quantum city. Yeah? And before I can explain you what we mean by a quantum city, I have to explain to you a little bit what we mean by quantum, because maybe I cannot assume that everybody knows. Many years ago, in the 50s, Richard Feynman, the gentleman that you see there in the upper corner, one famous physicist who won the Nobel Prize, recognized in a very famous article that he wrote that there is a lot of room at the bottom. Yeah? And what he saw in the 50s was the idea that if we were able one day to manipulate the constituents of matter, atoms, molecules, electrons, yeah, we could do a lot of things with them. Yeah? At that time, it was just a dream. Yeah? But today, it is reality, something that is done in many, many labs around, around the world. Yeah? So if the 20th century, yeah, was the century of information science and the century of quantum mechanics, yeah? Quantum mechanics, which is the part of physics that describes the behavior of atoms, electrons, molecules, everything that is small, yeah? And has given us the laser, the transistor. So you use quantum mechanics every day. You probably don't know. Yeah? The 21st century will be probably the century in which quantum mechanics will merge with information science, and will give us something that people call quantum information science, so that we will have something like quantum computing, quantum communication, and so on and so forth. It's quite easy to see that that's the way to go, because every time you buy a laptop, you know the processor is smaller, faster, cheaper, blah, blah, blah. Yeah? And the reason is because the connections on your chips get smaller and thinner. And these days, the dimensions of this object are so small that you can almost see already the structure of the single atoms that that constitute these chips. So you have to think about dealing with quantum mechanics in information theory. So under quantum information processing and communication, what we mean is that information, as we know it, yeah, is now stored, processed, manipulated, and communicated. Now, not anymore according to the laws of classical physics, not anymore according to the law of Newton. Yeah, there is no more the apple falling down from the tree. Yeah, but according to the law of the microscopic world. Yeah, and this implies a very big change in thinking. Yeah, because classical information theory is based essentially about the notion of the bit. Yeah, there is, which is an object that can be zero or one. Yeah, there can be your this gadget here can allow a current to be there or can stop it. So there is the current or there is no current. In quantum mechanics, we replace the bit by the qubit. Yeah? And the qubit is an object that is very, very abstract. Yeah? It's not just something that can be zero and one. It's something that can be anywhere on the surface of a sphere. Yeah? That's because of the funny laws of quantum mechanics. Yeah? The qubit doesn't live in our classical world. The qubit lives in a space that we call Hilbert space. And one way of imagining it is to be an object that lives on the surface of a sphere, on the surface of a soccer ball in the FIFA year of soccer, yeah? Something like that. This has very, very, very deep and profound consequences. Yeah? One of them is that, so as I mentioned, we replace the bit by the qubit, yeah? And the qubit has, because of this funny geometry in which he lives, has a very funny property that can live in superposition states. Yeah? So it cannot only be zero and one at one time, it can be zero and one at the same time. Yeah? And that is something very funny. Yeah? Because if you translate it to our world, it would mean that I could be here in my office at the same time with certain probability. Yeah? That's what happens in the little, in the world of tiny little things. And this has almost revolutionary consequences for the paradigm of computing. Yeah? That's why people now speak about quantum computing. Because in quantum computing, the basic idea is to replace your classical registers, yeah, through quantum registers that are essentially superpositions of classical registers. So instead of having a register in which you store 101, you can have a superposition of 8 entries, yeah, in the same register. And of course, this allows you to do many, many things at the same time, because you can, because of the laws of quantum mechanics, manipulate all of these entries that are superposed in a quantum register at the same time. So in one step on your quantum computer, you can do many, many, many operations. Yeah? And this allows us to solve problems that are unthinkable of today. Yeah? There are applications also for quantum communication. Yeah? And let me, just in a, on a slide, share with you what the big achievement and what the big problem is here. Yeah? One of the things that quantum computers will be very good at is cracking how we encrypt information these days. Yeah? You know, when you, when you buy something on some online store and you're typing your credit card number, it is, and you see the lock on the screen, and that means that the information at that point is encrypted. How does this work? This works essentially according to the following principle. Yeah? If I give you two numbers and I ask you to multiply them, yeah, that's a fairly easy process. Yeah? But if I give you a very large number and I ask you which two numbers did I multiply to get this number, that's much more difficult, yeah? Because you have to try all possibilities. Yeah? And this is at the principle that is at the basis on how we protect information these days. Yeah? And this is one of the problems that quantum computers will be very good at. Yeah? So that we know already that in a probably near future, yeah, these computers will be able to crack all the encrypted and safe messages that we send to each other, so that we have a big problem coming up out there. Yeah? Fortunately, if we look around a little bit in the tools of quantum mechanics, there is a quantum solution to this problem, yeah? Which is what people call quantum key distribution. Yeah? There is a physical way that I will explain in a second that allows you to share a secret key between two parties completely using the law, exclusively using the laws of quantum physics. Yeah? And in this way, you manage to to base the security of the transfer of information, not on a mathematical algorithm, yeah, that a fast computer could break, but on physical principles, yeah, which make it much, much, much more safe, secure. And the idea is very simply stated is this one. Yeah, you encode a qubit of information in a string of single particles of light, yeah, on photons. Yeah, and by choosing properly the polarization states on the side of the sender and on the side of the receiver, there is an algorithm that is called after Bennett and Brassard, was published in 1984, that allows you to do exactly that, yeah? To send securely a key, a secret key between two parties that you can then use to encrypt your information. Yeah? And this is what we have done in Durban a few years ago, in July, almost 2 years ago, in July 2008. Yeah, therefore, we realized this kind of quantum key distribution experiment on a real-life optical fiber that the city of Durban was kind enough to let us use. And it was a distance of 13 kilometers, and we managed to send completely secure information between the Ketomena area-based management building and the central application office on Howard College. Yeah? The physical distance is just a few hundred meters, but we added a little bit of of fiber in between. Yeah? And this was enough to convince the city, the Tequini municipality, to sponsor a project to set up a little quantum communication network in this city. So Durban was last year the first, probably the first city worldwide to own a secure quantum communication network. If you look here, this, this municipal building in Pinetown, in Westville, and here at Tequini Architecture in Pinetown, and so on and so forth. So the largest distance is maybe around 25, 30 kilometers. The shortest is around 7 or 6. Yeah? So Durban was last year the first city in the world to own its own quantum communication network. And that was very important for us because we were recognized even by colleagues that work for the European Union that they don't have it, and they were very jealous. Yeah? So they started investing in these kind of things because we have it and they don't have it. Yeah. Okay. And now, at the moment, we are busy to work on a project that we call the quantum stadion. Yeah, we want to secure the link, the optical fiber link between the stadion and what the city calls the JOC, the Joint Operations Center, between during the World Cup. Yeah? So that will be secured by the same kind of technologies. So these are just, I mentioned now, the applications that we have in mind at the moment. Yeah? But there are many other applications that people are working on and that we would also like to start working on. Yeah, if you look, for instance, a few months ago, there was a strategic report of the European Union was published, and you see the things that are expected to happen within the next 10 years is that this kind of technology will work via satellites. So at that moment, there will be a global network of secure quantum communication. Yeah? And things like that. And that is not all. Yeah? I just spoke about computing and communication, yeah? And cryptography. You can also, with the help of quantum technologies, do new approaches in metrology, in lithography, in imaging, in sensing, in control. So there are a whole new array of completely new technologies that are coming up that we will have to learn if we want to be able to compete on a global scale. And there are also people that already speak of the next generation of internet as the quantum internet. Yeah, when all these things come together, we will be able to have a new, completely new generation of internet. And there are studies that have been published that show the timeline at which these technologies will become available. So you see, in these days we have already quantum clocks. You know, the most precise clocks that we have are atomic clocks. Yeah? And every year, every 2 years, when our mobile phone company allows us, we get a new phone, there's 3G, 4G, 5G. Yeah? But this implies that the time measurement on your watch, on your clock, on your, sorry, on your cell phone, yeah, becomes more and more precise, because the information can be transferred fast only if the synchronization is also fast. Yeah? So this means that maybe in a few years' time, each of our cell phones will have a tiny little atomic clock inside to be able to do the measurement of the time very precise. Yeah? You see the quantum precision engineering, even quantum games, storage, biomedical applications, simulation, supercomputing, and so on and so forth. So these are things that are coming, yeah? Are out there and are coming. And there are already the big players that are moving in this direction, yeah? IBM, Hewlett-Packard, and others. Yeah? And there are newcomers. ID Quantique is the spin-off of the University of Geneva. Magic Q is a little it's a spin-off of, it's not a spin-off, it's a recent company in New York. Senetas is an Australian company. Yeah? And this newco, that's us. Yeah, that's us wanting to set up a company this year. That's our goal for 2010. Yeah, we want to set up a company together with the innovation company of the university that starts offering its services in this field. So our vision is the following one. The moment we have set up this company, and if you want, the project with the city have been our first test clients, yeah, is that we have managed essentially to go through the whole cycle, yeah, from research to development to commercialization. Yeah, and we want to keep this research, this cycle sustainable. Yeah? And in order to do so, the ambition, and this is where the vision comes, yeah, is that we want to create in South Africa and in Durban in particular, because Durban has been very good to us, we want to create a new quantum industry that is able to compete globally with other players in this field. So our short-term vision is just to set up next to our company a kind of a quantum innovation hub, a structure that allows on the one side to do fundamental research, and on the other side to help, if people come up with a good idea, spin off companies that can feed them in this vision of setting up a little industry. And it seems that Skype is very interested in us. Yeah. Yeah, so this is our vision. And the reason why we want to do it is that it's very simple. Yeah? Is that everybody speaks about lacks of skills in mathematics and science and so on and so forth. Yeah? But the best way to fill the gaps in this lack in education is just to show that there are jobs in this field. Yeah? And there are not many jobs in physics in South Africa. Yeah? So if you want people to study physics, you need to create something like a physics industry. And now we have the opportunity to set up an industry that could employ the students that have not yet decided, the young people here, that maybe one day decide to study science or mathematics or something like that. Yeah, and that's it essentially. So these were the people that sponsored part of our activities, and I just would like to thank you. And I finished on time.